So very happy to be here. I was so happy to be able to work on that project. As you know, I was associate director of the James Weldon Johnson Institute for 3.5 years. And basically in that time, I just developed a major crush on the man. I mean, so handsome, so refined, right? Such a Renaissance man, as she described. And without question, unequivocally, a man about the business of raising the quality of life for Black people in all dimensions, material and spiritual. As Joel Spingarn once spoke of Johnson in 1929, but he is that unusual thing, a poet who is also an effective man of action. So I thought the astonishing life that he lived, his creativity and imagination, his rigor and his tactical skill as an organizer had something to teach us about confronting injustice and forging solidarity in our current moment. But more specifically to the question, as curator, what did I want to convey? Well, because Johnson is known best as a songwriter and literary pioneer, I really wanted to explore more of his political writing. And with this exhibition, I hope to situate his political thought and activity within contemporaneous debates on the sovereignty of the so-called darker nations and within Black internationalist intellectual history more broadly. So Johnson comes of age while the Reconstruction is on the wane and Jim Crow is waxing. This is, of course, also an expansionary moment for the United States, marked by territorial acquisitions in the Caribbean and the Pacific regions. Johnson's professional maturation coincides with the construction of the Panama Canal, the United Fruit Company's monopolization of land and labor in the Central American republics, the U.S. military occupations of the Dominican Republic, Cuba, and Haiti, and World War I, of course. So amidst all of these epochal events, Johnson was very active in foreign affairs, and this is something that we don't generally know. He worked as United States consul and was chief executive of the NAACP. And over the course of his adult life, Johnson labored prolifically as a literary artist and press critic, exhibiting wide-ranging opinions on U.S. foreign relations and the problem of racial oppression as a matter of both domestic and international concern. So to me, Johnson was just the personification of cosmopolitanism, believing as he did in the universal right of all people to enjoy justice and respect as world citizens, and living as he did with a well-worn passport as an artistic ambassador, engaging with the cultural life and social concerns of the broader Black diaspora outside of the United States. So I was resolute that the name and deeds of James Weldon Johnson must never, ever be forgotten. But as I learned more about him, what emerged as a crucial narrative element in my reinterpretation of Johnson's political biography was an examination of his lifelong engagement with Latin America and the Caribbean in particular. This is not a typical approach to Johnson's story. Most often, he's framed as a 20th century race man advocating for African-American citizenship equality. And while that is very much true, I decided to recast him in this exhibition as a sort of liberal Black internationalist whose labors as a journalist, lobbyist, and organizer stressed the inextricable connections between African-American freedom and conditions of Black life and liberty outside of the United States. So meditating on the many materials relating to Johnson's life that I discovered in the archives, it also became apparent that his exposure to non-US racial logics through his travels and intellectual exploration reinforced for Johnson not only the arbitrariness of racial discrimination, but also the ways that nationality and language, place and position mediate the lived experience of Blackness and the possibility of Black freedoms elsewhere. So to get even more specific, though, I want to very, very quickly share some comments on the exhibition sub-themes that hearken to these Johnsonian ideas of racial malleability and the entwining of racism and empire. So the first theme, Afro-Caribbeana in Creole Florida, in that theme we encounter Johnson's hometown of Jacksonville in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. It was a kind of micro-society where people of diverse nationalities, ethnicities, and religious and linguistic backgrounds met. And I was particularly concerned with the linkages between Jacksonville and the Bahamas, and to a lesser extent, Haiti, in light of Johnson's Bahamian-Haitian lineage and the prevalence of Bahamian and Cuban migration in Florida. My intention was to highlight the circum-Caribbean movement of people, culture, capital in and around Jacksonville, and to present the city as a site of creolization born out of these layered geographies of Afro-Caribbean, Latin American, and African-American interaction. What I wanted to suggest was that this was Johnson's introduction to the notion of a larger intercontinental African-America. The other way that I try to treat the influence of place on the development of Johnson's character and racial sensibilities is to think about his family life and the kinds of Black community assets that would have surrounded him. So in Making a Way in the Gateway City, and another sub-theme, I use materials to help visualize the extended Johnson family as symbolic of the upward mobility available to some, though by no means most, Black people in the Deep South. Indeed, while Jacksonville signals in this moment across cultural space of Black intra-racial diversity, it is also deeply etched by post-Reconstruction racial tensions and the political and cultural shifts then occurring in the wider South. And against this backdrop, then, I wanted to amplify the racial uplift work of Johnson's family members and social milieu through their contributions to mutual aid societies, the arts, and public education. In the next section, Between Patronage and Power, Johnson has left Florida. He's finished college here in Atlanta. He's passed the Florida bar. He's set himself up to do all the wonderful things that he would go on to achieve. And he's living in New York City, where he's flourishing as a songwriter, but eventually grows weary and turns to politics, becoming president of the Colored Republican Club of New York. Of course, we know that there was a significant period in our history when Black people actually were Republicans, and that really was a thing. And I thought it was important to bring that back up for some of our young visitors to the exhibit and really grapple with that in our polemical times today. But again, I was exploring the evolution of his political consciousness. And there are some lovely materials that capture Johnson's relationship with other prominent Black Republicans like Booker T. Washington and Charles Anderson. But then we move quickly into what for me is the meat, which is Johnson's voyage into consular service, first in Venezuela and then Nicaragua. And I'll breeze over that because I think we're going to discuss that over the course of the hour. But after his separation from the State Department, Johnson begins writing for prominent periodicals. He is soon a contributing editor to the New York Age, then the most widely circulated Black newspaper in New York and a highly influential Black newspaper nationwide. His weekly column, Views and Reviews, gave routine treatment to Latin American, Caribbean, and other world affairs. And here he displays a keen sensitivity to the international dimension of race relations. So as a critical voice in the Black press, Johnson is essentially the public intellectual raising African-American awareness of hemispheric affairs and the ways that, according to him, and he argues throughout, the racist practices at the core of US interventionism really mirror the racist policies and practices domestically that undermine African-American progress. This period of Johnson's career also primes him for subsequent activism and agitation relating to Haiti, which rounds out the narrative arc of the exhibit in a section called A Self-Determining People, which highlights Johnson's strenuous advocacy efforts as executive secretary of the NAACP to end the U.S. military occupation of Haiti, which was from 1915 to 1934, partially through his efforts alongside and on behalf of the Haitian people. Johnson's leadership transformed the NAACP itself, enlarging the organization's field of concern beyond U.S. borders. And with the photographs there on display, I also tried to provide a glimpse of his relationships with Haitian intellectuals and statesmen and ordinary folk whom he regarded as comrades in a larger international struggle to redeem Black humanity. So again, this exhibit is just a snapshot of a truly exceptional figure that people generally know too little, if anything, about. He was American by birth, but cosmopolitan in outlook and pan-American in his pursuit of racial justice. And that's what I wanted to convey.
So,